Hello everyone, long time no see, eh? This will be a long one. I'm here to say sorry about the tutorial schedules, however, I also bring great news. But first, I'll need to clear something up. Back when I started making these tutorials, I imagined I'd be able to keep up with making new tutorial every weekend, but turns out that wasn't the case. Especially nowadays, I don't have as much time as I had when I started these tutorials, and I do want to say sorry because I could have done this tutorial much earlier. Alright, for the good news, I have some things to mention. First, the star of the start of the year. If you follow me on my social media or has been taking a look at my channel every once in a while, you probably noticed about me mentioning a thing called Ryannlib. As you know, just like I've shown in my tutorials, LuaSTG comes with a lot of assets made by Zun, and the usage of those goes against his guidelines. This issue was brought to me by some friends, and I decided I would pause the tutorials until I figured out a solution to this problem. The solution for that would be way bigger than I imagined, and turns out I brought something new to the table, that is, Ryannlib. Ryannlib is a TohoLib asset replacement package. That is, it's a library I made for LuaSTG that replaces all of these unlawful Zun assets. This replaces songs, sound effects, graphics, and even adds a new Rumia player I made. Obviously, this wouldn't be possible without the help of a lot of people, so don't forget to check the credits file whenever you get it. Talking about getting it, the link for it is in the description. The installation is really easy, so go ahead. I will also be using it from now on in the tutorial as well. Another thing I wanted to mention is that, as you can see in the start of this video, I'll be showcasing games made by LuaSTG users and also popular games made with the engine. If you want to be featured, please join the Bullet Hell Engine's Discord server and talk to me there, and I'll gladly show your work here. But enough talking, let's start with this tutorial. Today, we're going to talk about objects in LuaSTG. So what LuaSTG works upon is an object. Bosses are objects, players are objects, the bullets, the player shots, and many, many other things are objects. Of course, these may have their own peculiarities and exclusive behaviors, but without objects, LuaSTG would be nothing. Thankfully, we don't have to start creating objects as complex as those that I mentioned. Well, technically we have created objects in the past, as defined bullets, for example, are basically glorified objects. More intrinsically saying, a class of objects. But for now, that isn't very important for you to know, so I'll be teaching you in a similar way as I have been doing previously, as the editor can't get that complex before getting a little bit messy. So without further ado, let's go back to our tutorial project and create a new object. Right, we can start making our first object now. For organization purposes, as always, I recommend creating another folder named Objects inside Resources so that we can put the type of content in there. As an example, the first object we will be creating is a stage title card. Those are the stage information that pop up whenever the stage starts in Toho games, usually. In the Objects tab, you will find the Define Object node, which works very similarly as to how the other Define nodes work that we used in the past. The node itself has two arguments, that being its name and difficulty of it. In this case, we want to keep it on all regarding the difficulty, since the stage title won't change depending on difficulties. I'm gonna name it STG Tutorial Card. After this, we get to its onEndit node. There, we have a bunch of cool properties we can change. I'm going to gloss over a bit on this since it's a pretty big thing to explain in a video, so I'm going to link you guys two pages in the LuaSTG Wiki that describe more deeply these object-related things, so that it gets more clear. For now, parameters that we haven't seen yet are layer, group, and maybe hind and bound. The rest are self-explanatory, but these that I mentioned focus heavily on how this object will interact with other objects in its surroundings. Layer and group respectively act in specific ways depending on what layer the object is. For example, if an object is in the enemy bullet layer and group, it will act as if it is a bullet, and the player will die if it touches it, obviously, as long as the hitbox is set. Hide would determine if the object has to be invisible, and bound decides if the object will be deleted if it goes out of the screen. Now that we have discovered, I'll be linking together with this tutorial the image I am going to use for the stage title, and we will be doing its fading and movement. Now that you got the image, loaded it in the images folder and defined the object with these characteristics in layer top and group ghost, we can start coding its behavior. First of all, we have to find a good vertical position for the image to be in. You can start trying what you find best by creating the object in the stage and tweaking the Y position to find the height that you like. I personally think the height being 100 satisfies me a lot. Alright, now that you've chosen the height you want it to be, let's make it scroll from the right to the left, and make it fade in. For this, we will need a task inside the object to execute a move to command. But before that, let's handle the object fading in. As you can see in the picture, first I use a setObjectColor node outside of the tasks. That is, if we put it inside the task, we will be able to see the object for a single frame before it disappears. That is, because the tasks only execute one frame after the object is created. Now that you notice, what I changed in the setColor node is making its alpha to 0. Then, we create a tasker inside the task, which will execute our fading process without interrupting the movement process, as you can see in the picture. Here, I made a repeat node that loops 30 times and increases a variable that corresponds to the alpha value that we are raising in the object. Make sure to add a weight or the image will instantly go from 0 alpha to 255 rather than fading in. Let's see if it works. As you can see, it faded in successfully. Now, how about we make it move? First, set the object's spawn location to, for example, 100 and 100, that is being the position I chose. This will make the object start off at the right. Then place a move to node after the tasker we made that makes the object go to 0, 100. This will make the object move to the left until it reaches the middle of the screen. We can make it move smoothly in 60 frames with the move the cell interpolation mode. Fantastic, it worked! Now, let's make it wait 60 frames and then move away and fade out. The same way we use a tasker to make the object move to the middle and fade in simultaneously, we will also use another tasker to make it move to the left while it fades out. You may reuse the previous alpha formula, only invert it so that the alpha starts high and then decreases. I personally made it a little longer to fade out, though. Also, don't forget your weight. After your tasker, create another move to node that will make the object move to -100, 100, that is, even further to the left. This time, I will be using the move axo interpolation mode. After the object has completely faded and become invisible, we will delete it. Let's see how that goes. Awesome! We completed our first object. This is just one application of objects in LuaSTG. As you can see, they can have a lot of variety and options, so I highly recommend you to look at these pages that I have linked you to. Obviously, they are very hard to master, but will do wonders if you know what you're doing. In that case, if you're curious to see some other objects in action made in the editor, I also added some new things to the project file that you can try for yourself and see how it's made. For example, here's a Murasa anchor object that spawns some bullets. And also, Yuyuko's fan. And even Kogasa's umbrellas. And this is just the tip of the iceberg on how they can be used. Please experiment on the objects. There's a lot more you can do with objects, and I only glossed over them here. The best way to learn from here on is through experimentation. Obviously, I will keep going over things in the tutorial series, but the LuaSTG Wiki pages will be a great friend of yours if you use it appropriately. So get on your coding goggles and get to work. Thanks again for watching this tutorial. Don't forget to download Ryannlib and join Bullet Hell Engines for any questions or feedback in the comments too. Everything's under description. Goodbye!